Good afternoon. It's an honor to welcome Eduardo Souto de Moura, the laureate of the 2011 Pritzker Prize of Architecture, known as the Nobel of Architecture, to this event sponsored by SIPA and Columbia World Leaders Forum. Last June the 2nd, President Obama presented the Pritzker Prize to Eduardo Souto de Moura and praised him for creating buildings that inspired us and for a style that seems effortless as it's beautiful. Eduardo Souto de Moura has a unique talent to match beauty with simplicity. From the citation of the jury of the Pritzker Prize, Eduardo Souto de Moura architecture is not obvious, frivolous, or picturesque. It's imbued with intelligence and seriousness. His work requires an intense encounter, not a quick glance. And like poetry, it's able to communicate emotionally to those who take time to listen. In the last 20 years, Portugal has produced three world-class talents: Álvaro Siza Vieira, José Saramago, the laureate of the 99 Nobel Prize for Literature, and Eduardo Souto de Moura. It's the second time the Pritzker Prize is awarded to a Portuguese. In the last 20 years, only Japan has more Pritzker Prize laureates than Portugal, which is truly amazing given that it's a small country with so many problems. I just stopped at Columbia Bookstore and brought to Eduardo Blindness by José Saramago, the laureate of the 99 Nobel Prize for Literature, and Notes on Sensitive Architecture by Álvaro Siza, the laureate of the 92 Pritzker Prize. Other than their talent, Saramago, Álvaro Siza, and Eduardo Souto de Moura have something in common. None of them is from Lisbon, and they are all political from the left. Eduardo Souto de Moura was born and lives in Oporto, known as the Invincible City, and his office in the same street and in the same building as that of Álvaro Siza. Oporto is the city in the world with the highest number of Pritzker Prize laureates per capita. I invited Eduardo to give a lecture at Columbia exactly 1 week before he came to the US to receive the Pritzker Prize from President Obama. Honestly, I never imagined that he would accept because he's an extremely busy person and a world star. But he answered to my invitation, "I like the idea, I like Columbia, therefore I accept your invitation and I'll fix a date as soon as I come back from the awards ceremony." We have not talked again until yesterday, but there was no need for that because Eduardo is not only a great architect, but a wonderful person. We are living a turning point. For the first time ever, half of the world population lives in cities. For the first time in more than five centuries, the West is losing its dominance. Non-OECD countries are rapidly approaching 50% of world GDP, when 30 years ago they represented only 25%. There are 20 cities in the world with more than 10 million inhabitants, of which only two in the US and Europe. All this represents a historic transition. Great part of our future depends on how cities will develop, not so much in the West, but in the rest of the world. We need the contribution of architects with the vision and the talent of Eduardo Souto de Moura, not only to create beautiful spaces to live, but also to help us crossing this historic transition. So, without further ado, I have the honor to introduce Eduardo Souto de Moura, the laureate of the 2011 Pritzker Prize.
Good evening.
Excuse me, I got to talk in Portuguese. It's easy for me. I'm sorry, but muito obrigado.
Thank you so much for this invitation. For me, it's a great pleasure
to
be here at this university. I'd like to thank Dr. Manuel Pinho, who invited me personally to come here, where I've been here before a few years back, at the invitation of Kenneth Frankton. Thus, when I was invited, I immediately said yes. And the fact that I find friends of mine here, old friends of mine, it makes it even more pleasant. Second issue. I'd like to talk about when we talk about the architecture of the future, the city of the future. They asked me to say a few words. I'm not concerned about the future, but the transition to the future I'm worried about. Sometimes the future takes so fast to get there. What most concerns me is the present and what I have to do in the present and what I'm doing. So architecture through history has an element of continuity, and then there are certain ruptures which break with the, but they don't occur with tradition, but they don't occur overnight. The vanguards are dated by the historians in a single date. However, they occur, the history of architecture is a slower history. Casa is one of the most conservative, the home is one of the most conservative, houses are one of the most conservative institutions possible. The other day I was on the internet and I looked up a house in Mesopotamia, in Ur, and there was a construction that was almost identical to a house in the south of Portugal. In other words, the architecture changes little. The house has certain inertia and an identity that changes little. The materials may change, the techniques of construction may change, but the morphology, the shape, changes little. If it weren't that way, if we were always waiting for the house of the future, the astronauts would have no desire to come back home. About what I will show you, I don't want to speak too long. I know we're going to have a question and answer. I just want to show you a few of my projects, and then I'll jump forward to other projects. The last house I worked on is a house in Maia. It's done on two lots of land. One, two. It's a patio house.
Onde passa o metro.
Here's the subway, the train, which makes a lot of noise. It's closed off, thus we have these walls. The house has two masses, two volumes, two gardens, and the entrances near the area where the separation between the two areas. We see here the two lots, the two parts, the day area with the living room and the kitchen and an interior garden and a pool. And here's another entrance in the center and the bedrooms. And here is the garden for the bedrooms. It's an incline. It inclines towards this direction. Under this garden, there is the pool and the garage and the engineering room to take advantage of that garden. Here you can see the profile. The rear of the house, this is a marble door that gives access to the engine room of the pool. And here's the pool. A window here. It's the only window in the house in the back. Here is the gate next to a large tree. In Catalunya, one tree means you are welcome. If there are two, you shouldn't go in. This marble block is almost a decoration over the door. It adds a certain nobility. It's Italian, and it also indicates where the door is. And then we go through the door and inside. Here we see this block of marble, same marble. The marble goes through to the living room.
dá a volta.
It goes around.
E faz o fogão de sala.
And here is the living room.
The oven. A vista das salas.
Would be here. The fireplace. The fireplace would be here. This is the living room. This would be where the, this is where the swimming pool is.
Janelas que desaparecem.
And windows which can. Which can.
Janelas suíças feitas.
These are Swiss windows made in Portugal, and they open to the side. And
a zona de comer, this, piscina,
the, it's fed with spring water, the pool.
Sombra.
Here is a tree
e
for shadow and a window.
Paisagem muito feia.
To
pergunta-se, para que a janela?
People, so this side of the landscape
a questão que quero pôr é que tem alguma dificuldade em
not
abrir
as attractive. So,
nos muros e as janelas.
Sometimes there's a negative aspect to walls, but I think there are no ugly landscapes. What there are good and bad photographers, good and bad architects.
O construtor da casa é o próprio cliente.
The builder is the client himself. He did the construction. He dedicated himself tremendously to constructing this house. You can see here this tangent line from above.
E é completamente tangente e continua para o piso inferior.
And it continues all the way to the lower floor. That line. There is a separation of materials here, so working with wood and these joints here. And this is done at 45 degrees here.
A zona dos quartos com
here
o jardim.
Are the bedroom area with the garden, the bedroom garden.
Pergunta-se para quê? Aumenta a profundidade das aberturas.
And here is the opening.
E que está no quarto
and
principal, na cama.
Here's the main bedroom where the bed would be. You can see the garden through the mirror.
Zona da cozinha.
Here is the kitchen area.
Em que a luz
where the light
continua.
The light continues all the way down this way. Here we see the detail. And the negative space that receives the light is the negative space where you have the curtain. Here is the bathroom and a mirror on this side. We can see a small mirror here also, which helps to dematerialize the frame.
O remate final é em mármore.
The finishing touches in marble.
A entrada de serviço, uma
here
porta
is the service entrance.
Onde tem
a door that comes from the garage. Here
uma
is a mirror.
É
and a light, a double light.
A porta para não fazer
the
uma
door
caixa pesada.
We didn't want a very heavy door box here, so it's elevated. The doorknob is elevated on a relief. Here, the zoning laws don't allow for very high walls, so I had to cut it here, and I took advantage of this for a little spring. And finally, the doghouse.
Em que a natureza
nature has invaded it.
Foi a minha primeira experiência.
This was my first experience
in
building as a child.
Isto é o museu de uma pintora portuguesa.
There is
em Londres,
a Portuguese painter who lives in London, and I had the opportunity to choose the land. This is a city near Lisboa, and for a museum representing this art, I choose this area where the museum, the Ocean Museum, already exists, the Museu do Mar.
E era um antigo clube aristocrático.
It was an aristocratic home.
Diante da Revolução.
From before the revolution.
ao mesmo tempo que estava a fazer este museu,
and when I was working on this museum, I had just finished
o metro do Porto,
working on the Porto Metro or subway, where I had to
design
the actual stations and using excavations, and I had to cut a few trees.
Estava com o trauma e
so I was traumatized by that experience when I had to go to psychologists and the fact that I had to remove so many trees. So I tried 10 years later to make up for it. I planted 200 to make up for it, but even then people insulted me for this. So this has given me a certain complex. So then I began this work. I chose this area. This was where the tennis courts were, practically closed by the trees. And I decided to create a building that would be the negative of the trees. And I told myself, I'm not going to touch these trees.
Então, encontrei esta
so
forma,
I found this shape,
que era um pouco negativo,
which was rather negative.
Central,
here there would be a patio where these trees are located.
A ideia era fazer
the idea was
um conjunto de caixas,
to create a set of blocks
de lado, em relação a um corpo central muito alto,
with a,
que era
an elevated
a sala para as
center, which would be where the temporary exhibits would be. These trees here would be like a portico, and here we would have the bookstore, the restaurant, and the auditorium. You would basically, it would be like a, you would walk through these exhibit rooms, and they would be at different heights until you get to the end in a circuit form.
These blocks
were inspired by Paulo Arego's paintings, and the idea was that we would find the use of these doors and windows to tie the blocks together as links. Here's the entrance, receding area. Here's a door to the bookstore, and here the restaurant, and here the door leading to the exhibit, the temporary exhibits.
Entrada,
entrance,
através das árvores,
through the trees,
ver pela escala
and
das
here
árvores,
you can see by the size of the trees, the building was rather, would be hidden, so I needed a vertical element that would highlight it. So I opted for these towers, which had a high ceiling,
para ele ficar assinalado no meio destes,
so that they could stand out from these masses of these blocks of trees, these areas of trees, an inclined entrance, taking advantage of this natural entrance through the trees. And here is the entrance that announces the museum. The two pyramids, the architectural plan, the blueprint, and here's the circuit you would walk through, and you go back to the beginning. And in the evening, the museum, they close off the doors, and the auditorium and the bookstore and the restaurant are still open. There's a patio where you can eat outdoors. Here is the service area. And here, we had to, it was built elevated to project above the trees and to give a certain high image to the museum itself. Here we see the scale and it's an increasing scale, ascending scale, to diminish the impact. A lot of the contemporary art museums, especially for temporary exhibits where we don't know what will be there, we wanted to create a certain mobility inside. We could even have a crocodile on the floor. The entrance, diagonally, here we see the two trees. And this is a type of portico, a door. It's written, and here you have the date when it was founded. And here, the fact that I chose such a deep red was precisely to create a contrast with the green. When it's surrounded by trees, that color contrasts well with the trees.
A janela.
Here is
uma das regras também do
one
museu,
of the rules of the museum
é
is that every division had a window looking out, so people would never forget a reality. They would never feel claustrophobic. I am claustrophobic myself.
Isto é a janela da zona da
this
livraria.
Is the bookstore window.
E aqui vemos estas
and
árvores
here
novas.
We see the newer trees. And what happened was.
É que quando um dia cheguei à obra,
when I arrived at the workplace, the work site, and the shape of the building has positive and negative spaces that contrast to the trees, and they had cut almost all the trees. So I was there in the middle of the work site, and I asked them why. And the environmentalists who would say that you can't cut the trees had cut the trees.
Dizendo que não eram
saying
que não eram daqui,
that they were not trees from the area. It was racism because
então,
they said those trees are not from this area.
Tive que
so
pedir
I had to
ao presidente da
ask
Câmara,
the president of the chamber, the municipal chamber,
the
city hall, to plant trees as fast as possible.
Maneira a repor e dar sentido à
I
forma
asked
que
the mayor.
Isolado, mas se repararem bem,
if you look closely,
há troncos que já ainda
there are
têm
trunks
as fitas vermelhas, quer dizer,
that
há batido. O pátio do restaurante que, com quatro árvores que vão crescer
with red paint, and here is the restaurant.
Uma sala.
Here is a room where you can rest and look outside.
Este. Os materiais é betão, não é pintado. O
are not painted.
Uma tinta vermelha
it is a,
e tem esta peça de
the concrete
pedra,
is mixed with
é
a red it's a red actual it's a red
cinzenta.
Stone from the area the red gray
de Cascais,
it's called Azulino de Cascais this is the name of the stone from the region.
Esta cor para além do contraste
this color
havia,
not only creates a contrast
em relação ao verde
to the green and the trees but I did a test for a year in my office with putting the stone against out in the sun to see if it would fade and it faded a little bit and I liked it because it looks like this older type of architecture from a great architect who I loved from the end of the last century and I like the angles too and I used the angles that are evocative of that those buildings here and here.
A zona para o outro lado,
on the other side,
jardim, e é menos pública,
looks out to the garden, it's less
da parte
public,
administrativa,
it's the administrative offices,
com a zona pedagógica,
and the teaching spaces.
Esta. A livraria,
the bookstore,
com a entrada de luz de cima,
here is a
auditório,
study area, an auditorium,
restaurante,
restaurant.
Agora, uma pequena escala para quadros pequenos.
This is a small room for small paintings.
Quadros médios com uma zona de
medium
descanso.
Medium paintings. Here is the rest area with a bench. They insisted on putting paintings there too.
De quadros.
The novo rich idea of paintings, the mentality,
neutra.
Right? The novo rich mentality of putting paintings all over the place. Here, a window where people could sit at the bench and look out and rest.
Não se percebe este elemento. No fundo, era aquele marinho exterior que entrava dentro.
You can't see, but
este bico.
You can't see well outside, but this is there's actually a pipe that comes from the ceiling and comes through here. It's not really pretty. The interior patio, where that tree stood, and here we see light coming through. It's a built-in window, and it's regulated according to
the height.
It could work at 30, 50, or 100% brightness. There are no spotlights, no direct lights on the paintings. So we illuminated generally. This natural light illuminates the window with the exact same, almost the exact same brightness on this side and that side. And it's very graduated.
é que chegamos à sala
and here we are in the temporary exhibit room, and here the light is at 100%, which is difficult to really illuminate well from here to here, but it's all done without artificial lighting. Here's the exit where there's a bench. A lot of students come, and the teachers can sit down their students to explain, and in the end they can sit them down to see if they're all still there with them.
And this is the last,
because this looks like a Jacques Tati film,
where
people are asking, what the hell is this?
É uma torre que fiz no Porto.
This is a tower in Porto.
Era isto. Era isto. Bom. Acho que é isto. I think it's this machine. It's okay. Thank you. Isto é uma avenida, que é a avenida maior da cidade do Porto, que vai do centro ao mar, e a ligação à autoestrada que vai para Lisboa. E havia estes três terrenos. Este foi feito uma urbanização por um espanhol, este fiz para um banco português, e este o arquiteto Cisa fez para um brasileiro. A encomenda foi, a primeira foi a minha.
Owner and
decidi fazer
another one for a Brazilian owner. What I decided to do was a low ceiling building and another taller building a tower. In New York, we talk about towers. It has 25 floors, and it's in a recess. There are some stairways, and there is a plaza in the middle. The measures are 27 by 27. We started the project as Siga, I worked with Siga, my colleague and friend. We built these buildings in the same proportion. And between the three buildings, the plaza gets bigger, and then another building outside, and there is a bridge. So we have a plaza, three plazas, and people can walk around in this way, in this pathway. There was a bidding, won the bidding in Austria to build a casino, and we were walking through the Baroque style area, and we were inspired by the design. My friend's project was not sold, but mine was sold. We have another project showing the towers. We see here two central core areas. They are structural. The facade has the structure. Why starting by the facade? I like to work on the facade structure because it gives me a certain discipline, and from there I continue with the composition so that the finished product is completely autonomous. So we have the towers, the stairwells, and the plaza. And of course, this was planned with the size, the proportion, and the height was done thinking on the was done by the firefighters and the width by engineers. The structure couldn't go beyond 32 centimeters. So I had to build a building with the proportions already set up. that was not in line with the architectural, my architectural tradition. It was a system of progression, a mechanism of addition of blocks, where it doesn't matter whether you have more or less of this and that. And so we piled up pallets. I wanted to show what the pallets do and what is their function. They have a base that can be in wood or in iron or concrete or stone, and then the architect mounts the several layers, and then we have the olive on top as a crown. I submitted to the bank the final project, and they told me that it didn't make sense to present something so pompous. And I was sad with that, and I turned it into a closet for my house. And fortunately, the Spaniards, the Spanish group bought the project, but the crisis times were approaching, and whereas in the previous building, these pieces were in iron and the stones were yellow. When we reached this stage where my proposal was to turn the building into a store, então, a stand, iron was substituted by aluminum and the granite into other materials. So we worked on the elements and we came to the conclusion that it was going to be very expensive. So we decided to use rigid aluminum. And I built some structures, a set. I built a set showing the structure. There's a horizontal line. I didn't know anything about theater. So at this point, until this point, these are some wheeled structures, and for the chorus, for the opera, they use these kinds of structures and to form cityscapes or other landscapes. So these materials in the set look like a city. So these structures in wood, people can see the imitation of what I intended to do. From the fifth floor, nobody can see from here. We use the aluminum in the folded layers, like in the theater. The building, with the building, I wanted to say something that was alive. In the stand itself, we rehearsed the details. I wanted the interior to be in granite to give it a cohesion, a coherence, to use some of the neoclassical elements, in spite of the fact that the building was a modern building. In other floors, we show here the concrete, but it's too elegant for its height. The first levels, we use the transversal iron bars in order to give a certain stiffness to the materials. I remember when the Casa da Música of Oporto was built, my friend was staying in this hotel and witnessed the developing of that building, and he said that it was the same thing as Casa da Música. He told me not to close the building. But I hesitated, but went ahead. I continued to use the aluminum panels. The sunset gave it an effect of sun, eerie aspect. And in Oporto, we do not have the right climate for that, so office building like this would not be ecologically correct, environmentally correct. We have the plaza here and building, the construction, it opens up in the, to the north and to the south. The struts that hold up the pillars are closed, and we, on the sides there are corridors and bathrooms, which is the negative. Now it's the sunrise side and sunset side. The details are a false codec. And we can see from all the angles, they are false angles. These are not structural pieces. What we see here in bronze are lined with concrete. It's not concrete, actually, because there is iron inside it. To quote St. Augustine, the truth is the mirror of truth, but he's not saying the truth in this case. So I wanted to plan an office. It's not every day that we, the same person, designs the furniture for this building. So the furniture is a continuing of the building itself. They are made out of aluminum panels. We have candeeiros, the lamps, and in the background, the panel, it's closed. We have curtains. The air conditioning unit is unappealing to the eye, and so I use some plastic, and it's like a version of a swatch for furniture, of a swatch clock, watch for furniture. We have top here. This is a fragmentation of blocks of a block. This is the end of the building, which is this cornice. These are two abstract pieces, so to speak, but there is urban space. There are some roads or streets, more streets. And the texture of the building, there's a fenestration that you can see here. The plaza. Another street.
E quando olhava para o edifício,
and when I would look at the building, I started with Seagram. I looked at the low level and the high level, and there was something missing. And I realized that it was Calder, the link that made the connection between the high body and the low body. So I discussed with a friend of mine a sculpture. We started to study the shape of a sculpture, a dear friend of mine and a famous sculpture. He is deceased now. And we tried to find the proportions. He had worked a sculpture. He had built this kind of structure. And this also functions as a door. People walk below the fake door. And this is a system with doors and windows. It's a combination of materials that have a negative side, a positive side, and a negative side. And so it's a revolving entrance, a facade. So you make a rotation. And the true of the building appears before you. So we see a true pillar in concrete. We see the structure here, which holds the facade, and we realize that it is a false entrance. It reminds me of a text from Nietzsche that the face that is saying a lie is saying the truth. It's the truth about a lie.
Here's the entrance The rug I designed, black pavement, it's a mirror, it has a mirror effect that reflects
da escultura.
The sculpture.
O armário, isto é um candeeiro.
This is the closet.
Vemos a,
here
a
we
sombra,
see the shadows
pavimento,
in the pavement
da escultura,
of the sculpture,
do desenho do pavimento.
Which affected the design.
O edifício baixo é
here's
alto,
the low and invertido. Building. It's really an inversion of the high one, and the facade is like a cut in the building. Thus,
era como se fosse um
it's
corte,
as if it were a cut,
como se ele tivesse sido cortado
as aqui, if it had been cut right here.
Neste momento estou a fazer um.
Then I am currently working on a building in Milan.
Com base neste tema,
based on the same negativo, theme of negative and positive space.
Isto vou passar depressa, mas estou a
I'm going to speed up a little bit.
Fazer em Barcelona.
This is a project I just finished in Barcelona.
Na periferia.
In the outskirts.
Autoestrada para França. E uma construção toda desordenada, os sítios mais pobres.
Suburban area through one of the most poorest areas in the city. The city wanted to invest in housing and in a hotel, a modest hotel, and social housing for students and the elderly who have trouble paying their rent every month. So it's this is the extension. As far as texture of the ground, the park extends all the way through here. And I put these three objects at the crossroads of these two hubs, trying to create a center of a European city based on a crossing, an intersection. Here's the continuation of the park, a bicycle path, and these two higher buildings are like a portal, and this one isolated is the small hotel, and here's the plaza between the three buildings. Here's the site.
E como dar caráter com pouco dinheiro.
Since we they had
alturas,
didn't have a lot of money, the,
não é um jovem,
we worked on three heights, child, adolescent, and adult, and how to work with scale was part of the theme, right?
Quer pelo clima e quer pelo sítio. Essa tal ideia de praça,
so we were working
é uma cidade mediterrânea,
with the climate, with então, plaza, it's a Barcelona with the Mediterranean climate, so I wanted to create places where people could look at the sky. The shadow also was a factor, and these heights here are the same, which allowed us to tie the buildings and transform the space into a plaza space.
Vemos o caos que existe desta periferia.
We did the este novo centro. We tried to work with the chaos around it to create this
nova
new center and this new plaza.
Na periferia,
the new structure
um corpo central
of the
tudo
periphery
é feito and cartão para as pessoas poderem alterar.
And
é vendido,
this is
e esta parede.
These are movable walls, so the architecture ends when the where the facade ends. This was again was a project of little money, a social project in a very hot city, and they. I'd never worked with windows. I worked with different systems of. But never windows. I never worked with windows, but I rediscovered windows. I read this text, a beautiful text, in a spirit of courage from Robert Venturi to rediscover windows. And here he explains that I rediscovered windows. How can you rediscover windows in 1995? So I designed many different types of windows, combinations of textures, for weeks on end. Fortunately, there was something here in my favor. It's that the building, in this central part, the lower center, it had a 50 centimeter width. or a thickness. And the windows at 50, 40, 30 made sense. We had the historic window. And the window looks like a theater set with these three dimensions. It could be made of metal. The engineer had told me that for the building to be above the pavement, that the pillars should not be contained. In other words, they could not be perpendiculars because they'd go in this direction. So I had to create a certain lattice, a grid that corresponds to this alignment here. Thus, the openings had to be done within the limits of the structure, and here we can see. Another very interesting exercise was to do the details and to remember, again, an exercise I used to do when I was a student. With my friend Cesar, we had to do one detail which would be infinitely, the exercise, one detail would be infinitely replicated. So this door had to work with the theme of a door embedded in a wall. And here is tied to a closet in the middle of the wall. So, and here I utilized this system. The windows, and then the side, the corner windows to create this motif. We tried to dematerialize the wall. We were fired. They said we don't need you anymore. They never paid us. By the way, there was a financial crisis. So they sent me, but they did send me these photographs with the plaza, the pavilion. Here you can get an idea of this street. Modernism loves these abstract buildings, this notion of plaza, street, avenue, doors, the plaza you can see better here. Here is the passageway, stairway. A small street, and this is a stadium I worked with on for the European Championship in a city in the north called Braga. It's an ancient Roman city, and it pretty much ends here at this area. There is a 30 to 40 meter difference here in the landscape. This is a valley, and this area is not inhabited because it's a high incline. In this area here, the city hall wanted it here in this area, which seemed correct to me. Here there was a quarry where I went to take some photographs. And without understanding the least about soccer, I decided that this quarry could go down 30 meters and be like an amphitheater, a Roman amphitheater. It was a completely impossible idea because a stadium isn't an amphitheater. You need a lot of equipment in a stadium. However, when I went back to my office and I thought about it, and I thought, if I had 15,000 people seated on the excavated stone, and if we were to create another bleachers with another 15,000, if we had two bleachers, we could have a 30,000 seat stadium. These bleachers were on the actual mountain, and I could have cables which would cross and would support the roof. So, like in the Portugal pavilion with cables, I was able to do this construction. The problem is
A UEFA e a FIFA não
deixaram. FIFA, the governing body of soccer, didn't allow me because they needed more light and ventilation. Nowadays they don't require it, but at the time they did. So the light was projected through these holes. So I opened the roof at the same width of the soccer field, and I opened the stadium so that you could see the surrounding nature. I was inspired in the roof in those Inca bridges that have these rope structures with wood. This was the mountain. It had this shape. In the low part, a parking lot. You come from out here, you park, there's a plaza, and a set of ramps that give access to this area here. The seating area. And the top, another plaza. And people who are from the city, the locals, can go by foot. One or another, if they want to, they can park, or they can drive and park. And here, there are another set of ramps and stairways. If someone makes a mistake and wants to go the other way around, there is underneath a huge area where people can cross underneath the stadium. So, going through here, you can go down and up, or enter and go all the way over to the other side through this room. Here we see the blueprint with the ramps. If you're going up, you can use these stairways. If you're going down, you can go through these ramps. The first sketches, this shows the structure. They're like ribs.
And
here are the ramps. Here is a mock-up, and I love my country, but it doesn't mean we're very organized. So it got to the point where we discovered that there wasn't enough time to finish it and to do the construction. So they said, you have to do the same thing. You have to build it and finish at the same time. So the architects and the engineers decided to work in the following manner. We would do one design to excavate the land and mold the landscape with everything, the plaza up there, the plaza down here, the lower chambers, the VIP areas, the super VIPs, the television area, the journalists. And we had another team who would work on the design, this other design. So we had not finished yet. We had already molded the landscape accordingly. We had already removed millions of cubic meters of rock that are all here. This was sold, and this helped to build to buy the concrete for all this area. So we were working on two fronts, and here one we're working on the landscape and the others the actual design. Here's the excavation, already with the notion of having the plaza there, the area for the journalists, for the TVs, for the VIPs, access area. Here we see the cut in the rock where we did tests through explosions and perforations. They were perpendicular to the actual fissures in the rock, and we couldn't contradict those. So when we went to the side, the cuts were parallel to the fissures, and it began to fall. So we began to put supports and 25 meters, we decided to try to strengthen the rock. Here are some mountain climbers. And we worked in the following manner. I learned this throughout the years. They needed to know how we could open here, this area, to allow the passage
os corredores
of the corridors that would serve each level. And they needed the, we needed these proportions. The engineers worked in this, and we, this, we des, and they decided it could be this way, all working at the maximum limits. After 2 hours, this design was done. We were working day and night. So the idea was architects, engineers, it's like back and forth, and then straight to the actual construction. And when we practically finished is that we actually build this mock-up, this model in aluminum to see how the parts work together. Here's the actual construction. Here's the first bleachers, and here we see the circles I mentioned. Here are the negative places for the beams to actually place the corridors, the platforms. These are the corridors. Sometimes they were like this, sometimes contrary. This bleacher was finished, and we began to work on that room, that that space I told you where you could pass underneath through those ramps and then go up these staircases. In the middle, these is a, I won't go into much detail here, but these are access areas. In the stadium, it's prohibited that the public contacts the politicians, the journalists, the players. The neighbors, yes, but there's a moment where they have to, here's the locker room. They have to go down to the locker room to give them the trophy, and the journalists, the players can all assemble here. Everyone comes through the system of elevators and escalators and stairways, and they all meet here in this room here to deliver the trophy. Here are the prefabricated panels. This is not closed in case of fire. These pipes are for draining. Here is the ventilation, vents. An high, high-powered cable, electrical cable. I don't know why, but I thought that the youths would all be there at the inauguration, but they preferred going to Coimbra, and they weren't there. Well, here is the superior, the high plaza. Well, the interesting thing to observe is that the plaza should continue onto the roof. I thought that would be interesting. And here the stairs represent negative space in the plaza. But as I went, started building, I thought I could remove these and allow the rain and the light to enter. And here we began the construction of the bleacher. Here is the hipostyle. And here is the, remember the quarry where I took those photos initially. And these walls, these stone walls, cut through here, this stone, and it goes into the stone, and we left this negative space here to put cables. So this works in the following manner. The stone and they're held by cables. 20 centimeters. And they can sustain winds of up to 20 kilometers without waving significantly. Here's the plaza, the staircases, and here are those pieces that hold up the roof. And here's the beautiful landscape, the valley, and there's Spain in the back. And here are the double pieces, always two cables. They're placed here.
Entra o cabo.
Here's where the cable enters.
No Peru, presa a pedra.
A Peruvian using the rock as an anchor.
Estas peças que são antivibratórias.
There are these anti-vibrating
pieces.
When the wind starts to move, they swing and they will counterbalance the waving of the cable. And then here are the panels, aluminum panels, and these pieces can actually slide along the cables. And we finished the roof. The problem was where to the water go. I, who had spent so much money to suspend the roof with cables, couldn't put simply a pipe here. So the water is accumulates in a cane up in a drain here, and is projected out through this piece here, which is like a
onde tem a luz quase vertical.
It's and here is a vertical light almost.
Entendi que o que era importante no futebol.
I knew that television was so important for soccer. And a stadium is almost like a studio for TV. They have to have 2,000 watts light and has to be as vertical as possible the light for television.
A peça que produz ou que faz com que a velocidade da água seja sempre a mesma.
What allows the velocity of the water to be always the same? Here's the scale of the stadium, 30 meters approximately. And this is 26. It's one single metal piece. It projects out. The water will fall here. And here's a screen. It's necessary to have two. But since we only had two bleachers, I did a double one. It does not touch anything. It's standing. It's here's the sky. The pillars have metal that allow to maintain the angles of the roof. Here we see there's one rule, which is that the pillars are always tangential. They never cut the pavement, in other words, to try to create the monumental effect. This creates a, I don't know how you would say this, Pyrenees effect. Here's where the water drains. It is collected here, and here's where the light comes through. These modules are repeated, tangent pieces here in metal. If you go in and want to go up, there are elevators, there's bathrooms there, and this is the end of the stadium with these types of Japanese shoes. Ramps, those that go up, and then you can go up the stairs, and those that go down to go to the other bleachers.
No meio da construção, só queria que se cumprissem três regras.
There were three rules that we had to comply with.
Mas todos estes pontos,
all these points had to be tangential, so that this line would always be maintained on the staircase, and the circles would always have the same effect to guarantee continuity in the hallways. This was one of the effects we, you can see. And the drama was how to work on the facade. How to work on the facade of the stadium. A stadium is like a machine. And logic told us that this model should have stairs. So I did a sculpture. There are stairs that no one can use or else they'll fall. So they're very elegant. They are like an airplane wing. They're attached here. They look like they're always in the same proportion, but they get bigger and bigger like an airplane wing. Every door here is These doors have to be seen from far away. They have to accommodate crowds. Here we're in the middle, on the right. Here's the inferior space, the lower space. Here's the canal and the construction. And here's the using the mountains.
O tema das garagens,
the garages,
de cortar a relva, e o tema de que
and
eu acho que existe continuidade na arquitetura.
So I think we showed that there can be continuity. When I did this, while I was building the stadium, I went to Greece and I found three wonderful things. Stadiums.
Tem um primeiro bosque.
Or close, here is the woods that gives a certain comfort, and it also has an acoustic effect. And behind that, like a theater set, is the landscape. The second thing is the water can't directly go into the stadium, or else it'll create a cataract into the set. So the intelligence of the Greeks, who are now unfortunately in crisis, they would collect the water in each of these levels. Every level is slightly inclined backwards, which collects the waters and canals. And here are the stairways. And it's directed downwards. And here is where the water is collected and then drained out. It's a marvelous construction.
Esta imagem é talvez a que eu mais gosto do estádio.
This is one of the areas of the stadium I most like, because I hate this notion that what is concrete is bad, what is green is good. Water, rock can be natural or man-made. Here it's cut every half a meter. Nature never exists in this state. So the rock that came out of here, we used artificial stones here. So they live next side by side and create an interesting composition. And there is a link. It's like one came out of here and was placed here. And they work side by side. So they need each other to support those 200 kilometer winds. Here's a game, that screen I was telling you about, it's suspended, almost vertical light of a theater. This is a theater, the rock which creates great acoustics. When this hill is rebuilt with all the trees, this will look like a wooded section, like a forest. You'll see the forest and you'll see the mountains in the back. Here's the Braga bleacher, very vertical. And the architects, there's a risk that this won't be used for the European champion, and I have to praise the city of Braga, their city hall. We were very afraid we weren't going to do it, but we managed to end precisely on the 31st of December, on the deadline. So my client and I, we worked together with the engineers to comply with the deadline, and if this had not taken place, we would have been flogged and we would have been run out of town. So we became heroes, and the city is very proud of the stadium. The stadium no longer belongs, it doesn't belong to me, it's not my design, and now it belongs to the collective city. That's the best thing that could ever happen to an architect. The universities do exercises based on this stadium, and students also like this. I love the fact that the students are designing based on the stadium, but not only the students. The image of the stadium itself has entered the imagination of the population. This is the best that could ever happen to an architect.
And now, if you'd like to ask questions.
Do you want to sit or... Sit. Okay.
That was completely spectacular.
Foi completamente espetacular essa apresentação. Nós temos agora um período para perguntas e sei que estão todos a tentar incorporar essa apresentação fantástica. Eu sei que os estudantes...
That would be very helpful. While people are lining up, I hope we get some people to line up. That would be great. Or I'm going to have to call on people. I do that too. Maybe I'll ask a quick question. I'm out of my depth here. I don't think I just appreciated this enormously. I wish you were designing the stadium that's now going up in Brooklyn, New York, because this whatever you did, I think. We could benefit dramatically from your amazing work. So I understand what you did, particularly for the stadium. You were in an open area, and then you and there was one particular project also that you designed that was in a city. When you have to design in a highly dense populated area, do you take into account the streetscape or the activity that's going on in that area the way you did in the natural spaces, which, you know, you just made it more beautiful with your structure? How do you do that in the city in the more densely populated areas?
Isso é exatamente o que eu estou à procura.
That's exactly what I'm trying to do. There is a bidding to build the Lausanne Stadium and the one in Zurich. I didn't win the one in Zurich, the Lausanne, but in Zurich I want to build a structure with three windows looking into the mountain, and I am trying to integrate that landscape with the city and with the lake. That's Zurich. And so the city changes and the design has to change as well.
Okay. Question. Introduce yourself, please, and I think that would be helpful.
Sure. MBA 2012. I'm Portuguese as well, so I kind of wonder whether I should ask the question in Portuguese or in English. But the question is the following. When you designed the museum of Paula Rego, did you liaise, did you interact with Paula and get her inspiration in the design? Or you did it unilaterally without her input?
Well, I talked twice with Paula Rego, and that was enough, because as she said, she didn't like it that much. She explained to me that she didn't want the museum, and I went to London and we sat down and talked, and she said she wanted more of a house, and she gave me examples of what she liked, showing structures in London, and I understood what she wanted, and I sent projects to her, and she said okay, but I was hesitating because Portugal has so many great architects, so it was a big responsibility for me. And I told her that I agreed, but when we start the construction, that is going to become a problem. But she liked it. She wrote a letter to me congratulating me on my ideas, but I acted autonomously by myself. The architecture has to be done in that way. The architect cannot do anything against the wishes of the client. He cannot demand that the client has something built in a place and setting that he or she doesn't like. And the reverse also applies. He cannot force the nature of things. And if he does that, then he loses interest. Even with interest on the project, who knows what will happen. But if you are not interested enough and you continue to insist, what can happen? So she was a great client. And then the media, the museum is called Casa das Histórias, the House of Histories. So it they told stories, a lot of stories, but it's inventions. It's fabricated by them. And there are attributes and there are emotions, but architecture is like an iceberg. It's gelid. It's ice cold.
Mr. Demora, good evening. My name is Jacob Linetsky. I'm at the 2012 Columbia Business School. And the question that I have in building up upon the prior question pertains to the often contentious relationship between the architects and commercial developers. Can you reflect upon your private commissions and talk about the challenges that exist between the architect who may see himself or herself as the artiste and the owner in the future going forward of a particular design and a particular work, and a commercial developer that is driven by other considerations? What challenges have you faced and how have you overcome them?
The whole process in architecture faces problems, and I'm glad that happens because that demands certain things from the architect, because when the work is linear and simple, we are near mediocrity. So we have to create drama. We have to create a certain tumult so that the architect finds motivation. The biggest problem today, to tell you the truth, for the architect is not with the developers or the engineers, it's with the client, the proprietor, for reasons. And I'm talking about the situation in my country, but I said I love my country. But the problem is that society, or those who hold the power, the religious and political powers, do not give up their ownership of buildings. And many times they do not have the resources, they don't have the time or the money, which is worse. And then they ask us for the impossible. So they create time pressure and problems arise. And sometimes they change the materials because there's not enough money, there are subsidies from the EU. The problems with the developers today, with the existing crisis throughout Europe and especially in Portugal, a developer wants to finish the building, but he is not interested in doing something I have done so to make the money, but he has to count the coins for the cost of the construction. They bid with a budget that is almost negative, but they will try to recover that investment by using the errors that the engineer or the architect made. It's almost a problem of survival, I would say. I am open to proposals, to bids, as long as they are serious, as I explained for the stadio at in mid-construction, during the construction of the stadium. I made some changes in terms of the lighting and water and so forth. And we have to have accounting for this work. In this case, the engineer withdrew the concrete structures to make openings and that to make it less expensive, and we could buy the furniture with that money. So our relationship with the developers is not bad. It's the owner that sometimes has funding problems. I don't know if I answered your question.
Muito obrigado, boa tarde. Eu sou arquiteto, aluno do
programa de design urbano. Minha pergunta, senhor arquiteto, quando o senhor recebe recebeu o seu prêmio, o Pritzker, a notícia que foi divulgada nas manchetes no meu país, nos jornais,
the time of the super or star architects was finished. And my question goes regards that and your process of design and work and your idea of craftsmanship and development of each project.
It's a small question.
No, no, it's a big question.
That's what I meant.
O problema...
This American sarcasm.
Não, eu por acaso não estou de acordo com isso.
I don't exactly agree.
Quer dizer, vedetas, a história da arquitetura é feita com
vedetas. Architecture is done with stars. When the Pope would call celebrities to St. Peter's or Leonardo da Vinci when he would go to France.
A vedeta da altura, não é?
He was a celebrity, so when they had the Louvre tender, there are, in the end of the day, Fregheri, Tranculas, Freitas, in the end,
when talking about kings, for instance, in the 20th century, we had Mitterrand, the president of the Republic, and he had all the big projects in Paris. Not even before Pritzker. The other Pritzkers, they were not celebrities, and I am not a modest romantic against the celebrities. I was living in a country where I did not have the opportunity to stand out as a celebrity, famous. I would take the opportunity if it was offered to me. I don't have false modesty. I spent my life building houses, so I need to take advantage of the opportunities. I didn't have any member of my family who was an architect. I didn't belong to any political party. I was not politically correct. I was building houses and participating in tenders, working with architect Cisa. The first project that I was offered to me was this tower. I started with one level until, and I went up to 23 floors, and I didn't used to design windows. And then in Barcelona, I built structures with a lot of windows. Still about the celebrities, this perception that there was a commercial world, a narcissistic belonging to the celebrities, that now is going to change. Maybe it will change, but not for the same reasons. I built this stadium because the city authority called me to ask me for the telephone number of Calatrava, if I had Calatrava's number. I replied, no, I don't have it. But wait a minute, Cisa works above my office, and I'm going to go and ask him because they worked together for a pavilion in Lisbon and a railway station. And I told him, I know that Cisa has the phone, and I call you back. And he said, why? Or the deputy mayor said, we are going to build a stadium, and we asked for the budget, for a budget from Forster. It was in Braga, city of Braga, in the north of Portugal, and we thought it was too expensive, and also we were offended. In addition to the high price, the design, the project is like a Wembley, the Wembley Stadium. It's like a copy. We don't like that. So because it's so expensive, we want to ask Calatrava. And I told him, well, Calatrava is 20% more expensive than Forster. and for this and for that. And he said, so what should I do? And he asked me, what about yourself? Don't you want to do that? And I said, I do. And that's how the stadium was born.
Okay. Let's take
aceitar uma última pergunta, mais uma pergunta.
Hello, my name is Catherine.
O meu nome é.
I'm currently a student in the engineering school, 2012. My question actually is about what inspires you. Through your career as an architect, there have probably been lulls about what you want to do to face a problem, and what do you go to in order to get the answer?
I went through a lot of problems, but it's not a question of inspiration. It's the same thing as asking a writer, why do you write, or a painter, why do you paint, or a photographer, why do you photograph? I think that it's something that is likened to an impulse, to a drive. When there is not a commission for a work, we feel a drive, and you people get weird. Tired of the world, and one day someone asked me, why are you an architect? I didn't know what to answer, and I said, I am an architect because I think God did not create the world too well. He did not rest on the seventh day, because he didn't think about how we cross the rivers. We have to build bridges, and if we didn't have a house, we could not live properly. And I think that is a sense of injustice, of something missing, drive to do something better, to perfect yourself. And a journalist once published a headline in a maligned way, God must not have rested, because I think that it is.
So the history of classical architecture, the rules were that the artist should be inspired by nature. That was based on Aristotle and so forth. In nature is God, and learn the rules. If we learn the rules of nature, we can transpose them and try to approximate nature, until something brilliant came up, which was called the modernist movement, the famous Rambo sentence, which says we must be absolutely modern, and created something contrary. Nature should imitate art. It flipped it on its head. That is the most interesting approach. Go through an area and say, if I was walking through a space in a mountain, I was in France, and Cézanne had painted the same mountain 20 or 30 times, and that mountain is not a mountain anymore. It's a Cézanne painting. And we said, I forget the name of it, Mount something. And so when nature tries to copy art, that's what inspires us to build a better world. And this is true in other disciplines too.
Thank you. Mora, thank you for sharing your intelligent, inspirational, and dramatic designs with us. I hope we see more of you in New York and in the United States. We certainly could use your intelligent design. It's a pleasure. Thank you very much.